Hello, a quick note before the service starts. The service that you're about to watch was prepared and recorded just before the government announcement earlier this week. But I thought it was important just to acknowledge that for some of you, this week will have been a relief that some strong action has been taken, and for others, this will have been a very hard week and another blow. I hope that the content that follows will be helpful and uplifting and encouraging. But beyond the content of the service, we want to remain connected as a family, as a church family. So if you are struggling or feeling isolated, please do reach out and let us know, because the church family is here for each other. We're here for one another. Welcome to today's sanctuary service. I'm so glad that you've chosen to join us. There's a very lovely lady who's a part of our church who is appropriately called Rose, and for many years she arranged the flowers in our church building. And I can remember talking to her after a service one day, and she told me that whenever she finishes a large arrangement, she feels she could preach 10 sermons because she's so inspired by the flowers and the foliage she's been working with. And I suppose if you're a gardener, you know that same feeling, that as you see the seasons go by and you see things change in the garden, there are so many analogies, metaphors, parables that reflect truths of life and faith. And I suppose that's why Jesus taught in parables, finding things in everyday life or in the natural world that people could relate to. Now you can see behind me that my garden is not looking very glorious at this time of year. It's looking quite bleak and barren. But I know that there is treasure buried in the soil. I know that there is treasure beneath the surface. Not gold coins or precious gems, but snowdrops and daffodils and forget-me-nots and primroses and irises and dahlias, all waiting underneath the surface, ready to do their glorious thing. Well, that idea of being hidden, that idea of treasure in the context of the kingdom of God, is what we're going to be hearing about later from Monica, who's going to open up for us two parables told by Jesus. I'm also really grateful to Seb and Reuben and Bev and James, who are also contributing to our service today. So as we start this time of worship together, let's remember that we are connected in spirit, but we all have the presence of God with us, our King, who is so loving and faithful and always has been. Let's remind ourselves of that in these responses and then give thanks for his joyful presence in our world in our opening hymn. Lord, you have been our rock in every generation.
From everlasting to everlasting, you are God.
O Lord, we will always sing of your constant love.
We will proclaim your faithfulness forever.
We know your love will last for all time.
That your faithfulness is founded in heaven.
Praise to the Lord forever.
Amen and amen.
It's not just treasure that is hidden. Often we hide within us our fears and those things we are ashamed of. Let's now bring those things into the light and ask God for his forgiveness and strength and put our trust in him once again. Help us, O Lord, and forgive us when we offer you less than the best of our loyalty and service, when we resent your loving correction, when we grudge giving to the work of your kingdom, when we fail to value the fellowship of your people. In your tender mercy,
forgive us, Lord, and help us.
When through pride we will not admit our mistakes, when we make it easier for others to do wrong, when we bring upon them anxiety and needless worry, in your tender mercy,
forgive us, Lord, and help us.
For every unkind word we have spoken, for every action which has hurt another person, for every wrong desire we have harboured in our minds, in your tender mercy,
forgive us, Lord, and help us.
Lord, have mercy upon us and forgive us, that we may live close to you now and be with you forever in your eternity. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you. Our reading comes from Matthew chapter 13 and includes two more of Jesus' parables, starting at verse 44. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then, in his joy, went and sold all he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it.
Good morning. Such a delight and privilege to be here to talk today about these two gems of parables. They're about the kingdom of heaven, and I've really loved researching and remembering and learning new things about what this kingdom is. And look forward to sharing a bit of that today with you. I love parables. I think they're like stealth bombers that come into your mind and explode with meaning when we mull over them and think about them and ponder them and take them into our hearts and minds. So let me just pray before I start speaking. Father God, thank you for your teaching. Thank you that you give us these gems and stories, these parables. Help our hearts and minds to be open, ready to respond, listening with openness to what you have to teach us. Amen. So these two little parables are dealing with treasure of great value, and they involve two men who find this treasure. They're like twins, these little parables, and we went for a walk to Newton Park, the Bath University, and there was a huge tree there that came from one trunk but two massive branches, really beautiful, and it reminded me actually of these two little parables, twins, got the same kind of meaning but slightly different as they grow up. So in these two parables that talk about the kingdom of God, this is in the context of this whole chapter, Matthew 13, which is full of parables. There's lots of different parables, and a lot of them begin with this phrase, the kingdom of heaven is like. Now, the kingdom of heaven, also called the kingdom of God, it's the same thing. Actually, the Greek's the same. They're interchangeable. And so I might use both as I talk today. So one of the big questions is, what is the kingdom? And then the next question is, what do we have to do to get the kingdom or be a part of the kingdom? Now, just before I separate, so I'm sort of separating the talk into two halves. But just before I go into those two halves, I just want to look at the two parables and how the man in the parables finds the treasure. So in the first one, he's walking in a field, and then it would seem that he just stumbles upon it. It wasn't looking for it. but just finds it. Now, in those days, most people wouldn't have kept money in banks, probably weren't many banks around, or safes. So the way that people looked after their treasure was by burying it in a field that they owned. So this man wasn't looking for treasure, but perhaps he saw a little bit gleaming out and then dug and found it all. And then he acted on it, which I'll come to in a moment. The second man was a merchant looking, specifically looking for a pearl of great value. He was seeking. And when he found it, then he acted on it. And so two different ways of finding the kingdom of heaven. And that, I think, is the first thing that I want to say, is there is a difference in the way people find the kingdom of heaven. Some people are not looking for it, but perhaps a timely word, something that they read, the example of a holy life prompts that. That's like the treasure peeping out and makes them look for it further and respond. Other people are seeking. And actually nowadays that might be online, scrolling through articles, looking at the Bible, reading it, perhaps looking at different church services and perhaps finding it in that way. So some people are looking and some people aren't. The way that it's found can be different. So I come on to the first question, what is the kingdom of heaven? And I do just want to credit now, so I did chat to Paddy Gleave, who reads a lot of N.T. Wright and is great on the kingdom of heaven. And this book he recommended, The Kingdom Conspiracy by Scott McKnight. So part of the talk is informed by those sources, as well as just thinking and mulling over these parables. So what is the kingdom of heaven? Now, if we think about a kingdom, then we could say that there are four elements to that. A king, a ruler. A people who are under that king's rule. A land where that kingdom is established. And a law or a rule of life under which the people live and exist. So a king, a people, a land and a rule. So if we think back to Genesis and Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, this brand new creation kingdom that God had created. So you've got the people, Adam and Eve, in the Garden of Eden. God is the ruler. And the rule at that point was, do not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But we know that they did eat. And then things changed. The fall happened. And then the rest of the Old Testament is kind of like looking for a restoration of this right kingdom living. So human kings came and went. Often they were corrupt or fell away or evil, did evil in the eyes of the Lord. The people were the Israelites. The land was that promised land of Israel where they were trying to get to be established. And the rule was the Ten Commandments given to Moses by God for the people that were then expounded on and this rule that's found really in the first five books of the Old Testament, the Torah. And then what follows really throughout the whole Old Testament is this cycle of rebellion where the people go away from God and the rule and reject him in favour of other things. And then they're brought back to repentance, turning back to God. And then restoration, as he restores again that relationship and there's a sort of fresh start. And this goes on and on, rebellion, repentance, restoration. So we reach the end of the Old Testament and it's still not been fully fulfilled, but then there's a whole brand new phase, a whole new way of life that's heralded by Jesus. And actually the Gospel of Mark is really interesting on this because the Gospel of Mark doesn't include any bits of the nativity story of Jesus' birth. It comes in with John the Baptist heralding the arrival of Jesus. And then Jesus comes on the scene quite quickly and the first thing he says is, the kingdom of heaven is near. Repent and believe in this good news. So I think that's really significant. Marka Muggeridge puts it like this: Jesus' good news then was that the kingdom of God had come. Jesus was its herald and expounder to mankind. More than that, in some special, mysterious way, he was the kingdom. So we've got Jesus walking around, teaching, healing, drawing people to himself as his disciples and followers. Jesus, the light of the world in whom we find life. Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus, exemplifying this new kingdom, the kingdom of God. So there's a change then in this kingdom and what it means. So then Jesus is the king. The people are those who respond to him, those who find this treasure and respond to it. The rule, so Jesus said, I came to fulfill the rule, not change it or take away from it. But then he gives out this new rule, a rule of love. And actually, you know, we're reminded of the Beatitudes from the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5, where there is advice and teaching given about how we are to live. The rule of love. The people, anybody and everybody, doesn't matter what nationality you are, what gender you are, your age, your ability or disability, we're all drawn in to love God and follow this upside down rule of love your enemy, do good to those who hurt you, love, 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 love your neighbour and love God. And the land is going out from Israel to the whole world. The land is where the believers walk and tread, spreading out from Israel, as we see in the book of Acts, once Jesus had died and was resurrected and the disciples went and spread the word. I just want to quote from this book, The Divine Conspiracy, which I know I've quoted from before. So Dallas Willard says, Jesus offers himself as God's doorway into the life that is truly life. Confidence in him leads us today, as in other times, to become his apprentices in eternal living. He brings something to our ordinary lives of coping and little things. This life, which has the quality of eternity about it. He brings us a sense of joy, fulfillment, and peace amidst whatever is going on externally. So for those of us who have found this treasure, this kingdom of God, we are the people of God. We are his kingdom on the earth. So where we walk in some mysterious and supernatural way, that is where the fragrance of the wind of his spirit spreads around. This kingdom which is here through believers and is yet to come in future hope. So what Jesus was doing and is still doing was bringing this kingdom, like the yeast in the bread, like the wind that blows, in mysterious and remarkable ways, drawing people into fruitful, holy living, living a life of love. So the question as I bring this first part to a close is, have you found the treasure? Have you stumbled across it? Or have you been seeking? And have you found this treasure, which is the kingdom of God? We're just going to pause now, and Bev Harris is just going to read a poem about the kingdom of God.
The Kingdom by R.S. Thomas. It's a long way off, but inside it there are quite different things going on. Festivals at which the poor man is king and the consumptive is healed.
mirrors in which the blind look at themselves and love looks at them back. And industry is for mending the bent bones and the minds fractured by life. It's a long way off, but to get there takes no time, and admission is free if you will purge yourself of desire and present yourself with your need only and the simple offering of your faith, green as a leaf.
So just in the last few minutes, I want to ask a question. What can we do to get the kingdom of God? What do these parables teach us about how we become part of that kingdom of heaven on earth? So both men in the parables go away and give everything to get this treasure that they've found. And it does remind me of the interaction that Jesus has with a rich man where Jesus says to him, you need to go away and sell everything. And the man went away sad because he couldn't do that. So one of the questions is Jesus asking us to sell everything to follow him through these parables? I don't think he is, but I do think that he's asking us to give everything in an attitude of surrender to him. It's one of the paradoxes of the Christian gospel message, that it was freely given. We can't do anything to earn his love. It's readily available for anybody who wants it. And yet, it costs everything that we have to be a part of it and to, as we respond to finding it, to Jesus. So it's that attitude of saying, everything that I have, who I am, all that I possess and own, belongs to you, Lord. Do with it, do with me, whatever you will. It's a challenge. It's that acknowledgement that we're just here as temporary citizens passing through on planet Earth for but a breath, really, in the big scheme of things. And to say, my house, God, it belongs to you. Help me to use it for ways that glorify you and bring you joy and bring people to know you and love you. My car, my bank balance, all that I have, my job, can I say genuinely, wholeheartedly, Lord, use whatever I have, use it for your glory. An attitude of complete openness before God, of saying, do with me what you will. I just want to read a couple of sentences from Thomas A. Kempis's book, done here, The Imitation of Christ. So there's a little paragraph called Putting Our Whole Trust in God, which kind of sums up this attitude of allowing God our lives. Lord, your care is greater for me than any care I can take for myself. Lord, as long as my will remains straight and firm in you, do with me whatever pleases you. For it cannot be other than good. If you wish me to be in darkness, blessed be you. If you wish me to be in the light, again, blessed be you. I am willing, without difference, to take from your hand good and ill, sweet and bitter, sad and glad, and to give thanks for all things. So these two parables offer both great encouragement. The kingdom of heaven is like great treasure. But they also offer huge challenge. Will we respond and give our lives to Jesus and be part of that kingdom on earth, be part of the kingdom living of his people, following his rule of love, somehow by the wind of the Spirit being that presence on the land of God and his kingdom? Let me just pray to finish. Father God, thank you for this great treasure, this wonder and mystery of the kingdom of God within us through your Spirit. I do pray that you'd help us to respond joyfully and gladly like the men in the parables and to give you willingly our lives and all that you have given us so that we may be used for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Riches beyond all measure could never satisfy my gratifies in part. All that this world can offer can never compare to all you are. You are my greatest treasure, the desire of my life.
Our greatest treasure is our gift of life, so let's recommit that to God now in the words used by the Methodist Covenant Prayer. I am no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will. Rank me with whom you will. Put me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be employed for you, or laid aside for you. Exalted for you, or brought low for you. Let me be full, let me be empty. Let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and wholeheartedly yield all things to your pleasure and disposal. And now, glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine and I am yours. So be it. And a covenant now made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. We are citizens of a kingdom and also citizens of a nation. So we pray too for our country, its leaders, and our communities. As we enter into another period of national lockdown, we ask, gracious God, that you will protect the mental health and well-being of our children and young people and their families. show us how we can be kind and gentle with ourselves and with each other, and help us to be led by the slowest members in our households. Replenish in us the physical and emotional resources we all need to be able to help our children and young people to continue learning while schools are closed. And by your Spirit, may we grow in love, joy, peace and patience as we continue trusting in your faithfulness and promises. We praise you for the blessing of our National Health Service, for the many dedicated individuals who care for us from our first cry to our last breath. As COVID-19 infections continue to rise, we ask that you will give all frontline healthcare workers peace, resilience and proper rest so that they are not worn down by the demands of their roles. Guide all of the planners and decision makers as vaccinations are distributed and start being implemented. And by your Spirit, enable us to be free from fear or anxious thoughts as we wait patiently for our own vaccination. We also pray for our nation's businesses, for multinational conglomerates operating around the world to sole traders. We are so grateful for the diversity of goods and services that are available to us, for the convenience of being able to access them, and for the communities that these businesses create and support. We lift up to you business owners that are struggling to make ends meet and those that have lost their livelihoods. We ask God that you will help each one to seek the practical support that they need, and that new opportunities will be created for them to use their skills, vision and entrepreneurial spirit. Help us too, as consumers, to be discerning in how we spend our money, to be generous and thoughtful. We hold before you, Father God, our government, members of parliament and local councillors. Thank you for their public service and commitment to represent their constituents. Thank you for their hard work and desire to seek the common good. Bless them, we pray, with strength, perseverance, wisdom and humility as they discuss policy and make difficult decisions in the days, weeks and months to come. And I will give thee the treasures of darkness and hidden riches of secret places. We pray for our community and in particular our own family, friends, neighbours and colleagues for whom life feels difficult and dark. We think of and lift in silent prayer by name to our loving Heavenly Father, people we know feeling claustrophobic because of lockdown, people who are isolated and separated from loved ones, people who are fearful of the future, people who are in pain or discomfort, waiting for delayed treatment or the outcome of hospital tests, and people who are grieving the loss of family members that they love. In particular, we remember before God the family of John Tinkler, who died on Christmas Day, that they will be comforted as they mourn, experience joy as they celebrate his life together, and be assured of the hope that he had of new life through Jesus Christ. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. May we, each in our own unique way, reflect the light of Jesus' care and compassion to the people we are journeying with. And strengthened and inspired by the Holy Spirit, may we lead others from darkness into the knowledge and personal experience of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. We join now together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen.
So we're coming to the end of our sanctuary service now. I hope this has been a time that has been both encouraging and challenging for you. We do love to hear from you, from all those who find these sanctuary services helpful, both those here in Bath and those who get in touch from around the country. And we want to be inclusive and involve as many people as possible. So if you have a reading or a song or a story you'd like to share, please do get in touch. One final thought about treasure. Like my garden here behind me, you may not feel like you look very fabulous or glorious, but we're reminded in the Bible that all of us are just like rough old jars of clay. But the treasure is within. And so in this final prayer, let's commit to share that treasure, the treasure of God, with those who we come into contact with this week. And then right at the very end of our service, we're going to hear a very joyful version of the Lord's Prayer, sung in Swahili. It reminds Monica of her time living and working in Kenya.
Father, we dedicate ourselves to serve you faithfully and to follow Christ, to face the future with him, seeking his special purpose for our lives. Send us out to work and to witness freely, gratefully, and hopefully in the power of the Spirit for the honour and glory of your Son, Jesus our Lord. Amen.
And may God the Father keep us in all our days. May God the Son shield us in all our ways. May God the Spirit bring us healing and peace. May God the Holy Trinity drive all darkness from us and pour upon us blessing and light.
Amen.